Just wanted to give you guys a quick reminder, if you guys love my videos and want to support me, check out compassion-teas.com. Link is at the end of the video.
Hello with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you coming at you from my beautiful backyard garden here. And after last episode you guys saw at Veronica's place, if you guys didn't see that, check the link down below. Definitely really cool. I'll put it in the description. Toured her place and her growth for her winter garden looked totally amazing. And I was like, man, she's doing a few things I'm not, right? And I think one of the things that I really haven't done in the winter season, because it's been pretty cold and I haven't been out in the garden too much, is actually basically inoculate my garden with beneficial microbes. And there's many ways to do this. You know, she was using maybe like IMOs, indigenous microorganisms, you know, cultured off rice, which is, hey, that's great. That's one way to do it. But, you know, I like to do it in different ways. And I'm not going to say one way is better than another way and people wants to fight. John, man, indigenous dude, you're missing the boat, man. They're like the best. I don't know, you know, so here's the thing, like, I think that all microbes are great, and I don't discriminate against any color person based on their color, but, you know, and I don't discriminate against any microbes, and you guys shouldn't discriminate against microbes either. Like, are IMOs better than, you know, the EM1 or better than, you know, compost tea, should you make it? I don't know, man. What I'd recommend for you guys is just get them all in your garden. We want all these microbes in your garden, because guess what, right? Once you have the biggest variety of microbes in your garden, right, they're gonna figure out who's gonna survive, who's gonna live in your specific environment. You know, if you have some kind of fungal disease and the microbes in the EM1 eat that disease, great, right? And or if the IMOs eat that disease, great. The whole end result is you're not gonna have that disease, but if you put EM1 and it needs a microbe that's in compost tea, it's not gonna work, right? So I want you really get to the broad spectrum. And if you're like a soil scientist and do all these microscope things with, you know, bacteria, you probably know more than I do. But, you know, I'm just like, this is like the more lazy man, common man approach. It's not like super scientific. You know, I just figure that, you know, let all the microbes compete for themselves. And they're going to figure out which ones are going to be the dominator species and which ones are going to be great. But if you don't put a wide spectrum, you will never have a wide spectrum in your garden. And of course, there's also microbes living in your soil now, unless you've sprayed, like, you know, heavy chemicals like Roundup and synthetic chemicals and things that could mess up the soil. But they just might not be in high enough numbers really to make a big difference. And so that's why I regularly like to, you know, introduce them into my garden in various methods to do many things. You know, the microbes and beneficial yeast and fungi can, number one, attack other bad fungi and microbes, bacteria, you know? I mean, there's some research that indicates that EM1 could be, you know, could be very beneficial against, like, E. coli and things, right? I even heard of, like, you know, slaughterhouses using the EM1 to clean their drains and stuff so they're not polluting the water system, which is kind of funny to think about. But, you know, so, like, that's the whole thing. Like, the microbes are essential to life. I mean, we are more microbes than human, it is said. The microbes help us digest our food, and literally, the microbes help us digest our food, but it also helps our soil digest the nutrients in there, break down the organic matter in there, break down the minerals in there, and make them more bioavailable for the plant. So number one, it's increasing your fertilizer, your fertility engine, without having to add synthetic fertilizers, right? Number two, it also could prevent bad diseases, right? If you have some Pythium or Fusarium, you know, there's been some, you know, reports that I've seen EM1 is beneficial against those diseases that commonly can affect plants. And as well as, like, you know, different kinds of funguses and molds and powdery mildews, right? If you have the beneficial microbes on the leaf's surface, then what will happen is they're going to basically either A, outcompete, and they're already filling the space to live so that other things that are worse or bad things can't live there, or they're going to actually just eat the bad things that do land on there, and it's basically their food source, because, you know, it's a war out there in microbe land. So anyways, as you guys figured out, I'm a big believer of microbes. Which one's the best? Which one's the worst? Well, I want to talk about two of them, the two common types that I personally use in my garden. There's other kinds that I've experimented over the years, but these are two solid ones that I definitely believe in and trust. Number one is the Boogie Brew Compost Tea. Now, you guys could make your own compost tea, And compost tea is not compost tea is not compost tea. I mean, you could shit in a bucket and put water in there and call that a compost tea. You know, the compost tea is only going to be as good as the ingredients found in the compost tea. And if you're making your own compost tea, these ingredients will vary batch after batch. I mean, I've been to the Boogie Bunker where they make the compost tea. I'll post a link down below if you want to know exactly what's in here and the different kind of proportions they use. A lot of the ingredients are standardized, which means every time they get that ingredient, like soil humates, it's pretty much the same soil humates they got 5 years ago. Whereas some of the compost and the worm castings they've used in the Boogie Brew Compost Tea changes over time. This batch may be different than that batch, and actually, I know Josh is constantly, you know, improving his worm castings that he's using. He's using better worm castings now than he did 5 years ago, so it's probably actually a better product now. But nonetheless, there's gonna always be some variety, and then you have to, you know, you could buy this, which is great. I'll post a link down below if you guys wanna get the best deal on the Boogie Brew Compost Tea delivered to you. And the challenge with this stuff is that, number one, it's variable. So the results and the bacteria and the microbes and the fungal dominated, you know, fungi in there and the bacteria are gonna vary batch after batch. And you don't exactly know, depending on also how long you brew it, the temperature that you are brewing it at. And in addition, of course, you know, the compost tea is not gonna be ready for 24 hours. You know, if I want to spread out compost tea in my garden today, I would have had to plan and started this process yesterday by brewing compost tea, you know, inside at this time of year, because it is so cool and cold outside, and compost tea and the microbes don't really like to live in too cold or too hot of an environment, actually, in that case. So yeah, it takes time, you gotta buy extra equipment, and I'm not to say that it's bad, but, and then you don't always have the same exact results, so you can't ever find like a studied, reviewed compost tea to see if you get the same exact results every time, because the batch itself is always gonna be a little bit different. It's gonna have a little bit different microbes in there based on the time of year, based on the food source, based if Josh, you know, put a little bit of this ingredient in this time or a little bit more of that, if he's not measuring things accurately because he's on cloud nine. Who knows? Not to say that it's not good, but, you know, I know a lot of you guys have actually used this and gotten really good results, as have I, right? So that's where, you know, the lazy man's compost tea is EM1. And am I going to say EM1 takes the place of compost tea? You know, and EM1 is better than compost tea? You know, everybody always wants to know, what's the best, John? I'm just going to use the best, you know? And it's like, for me, I don't really like to look in terms of, like, best and worst, you know? I like to maybe think good, better, best, and I just like to think in a range, right? And if you think this is the best, then you're basically excluding all the others, you know, from the choices and from what you're doing, right? And so I think that this could be an excellent adjunct to, or, you know, use this in addition to that, or use that in addition to this. I mean, use all the microbes you guys can. There's definitely some benefits to the EM1 over the compost tea, and there's definitely benefits of the compost tea over the EM1, you know? I guess probably the cost per serving, or cost to spread out in your garden, the compost tea is basically a dry product that you will add your filtered water to, and then basically make a lot more. You know, the EM1, this is a concentrate, so this will also be added to your, you know, chlorine-free water to make a lot more. That being said, if I have to, like, compare the cost dollar to dollar, the compost tea is more efficient because you will get a lot more microbes for less money. You also have to invest in, you know, a brewing bucket and a pump and all this kind of stuff, and you have to brew it for, like, 24 hours. Whereas this, the cost might be more per serving, but it's available instantly, right? I mean, there's an expiration date on here. You need to use it by the expiration date. And once you, if it's in a sealed container, it'll be good to that expiration date. But once you open this, and they do have a nice seal on there, but once you open and break that seal, you need to use this fairly quickly, because in the environment that it's stored in, it is shelf stable, as long as it doesn't freeze and it stays at, like, you know, your normal home temperature that you would keep. But once you open it, you should be using it, you know, more sooner rather than later. And so it's available now, and so cost per serving is more. And the other thing I like about the EM1 specifically is because it's basically, you're basically guaranteed an analysis, provided it's actually active inside here and something didn't go haywire with the batch and it hasn't been sitting on the shelf too long and it's not expired. You're basically gonna get a few things. You know, what they claim on here is a few ingredients. Number one, they claim, like, photosynthetic bacteria. Number two, they claim yeasts. And number three, they claim lactic acid bacteria. Now, there may be other things in here that I'm not sure of that they're not claiming, but this is what they are claiming in here. And each one of these have their own benefits, and some of these ingredients in here may not be in compost tea. So really, we want to get that synergy of both. We want to use both of them. And each one has its own specific situation. Like if you live in an apartment, you can't have a big compost tea brewer. You don't want to be brewing stuff. You want stuff bubbling over because your girlfriend or your wife gets, you know, pissed at you if you're making a mess or there's extra noise or whatever. Then this stuff's easy. You just pour it out, dilute it in clean water, and just spread it out in your garden like I'll be doing today, right? And I know I need to spread some of this stuff out because I want to increase my plant growth and, you know, get more disease protective, as I'll be talking to you guys about in a little bit, like how I believe the EM1 literally saved one of my actually 6 foot tall tree collards from dying because I actually had sudden infant tree collard death. Well, it wasn't an infant. It was like 2 years old, and I had one literally tree that died, and it was quite sad to me. And I believe that's because some kind of fungal infection that the EM1, when I sprayed on it, like, you know, several times, you know, the tree collard basically reemerged. So it's amazing. So the EM1, you know, it has different creatures in there basically, and some of them I really like, right? The photosynthetic bacteria is quite interesting because it has bacteria in here that you literally will spray on your plants, on the leaves of the plants, right? And this bacteria literally doesn't like suck nutrients out of your plants in any major part, but it takes the sun's energy and it basically makes food, makes nutrients, it's able to live, and then it basically poops out, for lack of a better word, nutrients that your plants can absorb through their leaves. So this actually makes your plants more efficient, right? Totally amazing. The lactic acid bacteria obviously is there to break down bad pathogens as well as break down, you know, nutrients in the soil and make those available. And also, if you're making like sauerkraut, right, you are, you know, there is lactic acid bacteria all over the place, you know, but now you can increase the numbers to hopefully crowd out the bad guys. And of course, there's the beneficial yeasts, right? My research isn't all the biggest on the beneficial yeast, but, you know, I know this, that there's beneficial yeast that we should be having that can prevent candida overgrowth within us, right? And so good yeasts eat out bad yeasts, you know, so nature's a self-balancing system, and especially when we have imbalanced nature by removing nature or by spraying chemicals that kill all these natural creatures, whether they're bacteria, yeast, or fungi, then the system gets out of balance. So I think, you know, introducing these back can be quite beneficial. And unlike this compost tea, that research can be spotty because compost tea is only going to be good as the recipe, which is definitely not standardized, and you're going to use different compost every single time. This is standardized, and there has been a lot of documented research studies on this, both good and bad, right? You know, my personal opinion on the EM1 is if you live in a tropical environment where it's really warm most of the year, because a lot of these bacteria like and creatures in here like to live in more warmer climates. You know, today I'm in the sun, and it's in the sun, it's like probably 70 degrees on my face, maybe 80, maybe pushing 80. But it's like 52 degrees in like the shaded areas of my garden. You know, that's just the temperature. And so the bacteria, the fungi, and yeast and all this stuff, they all have a, you know, temperature range that they're operating in, right? It's kind of like us, right? If it's cold outside, you guys are moving a lot slower, right? We're just not moving quite as fast when it's the winter time. Things just happen a bit slower because it's cold. You don't feel like moving. You don't feel like going outside. And when it's hotter, you might move a little bit quicker, or you might actually slow. Well, in the optimal temperature range, you're like totally perfect. When it's too cold, you're a little bit slow. When it's too fast, you might slow down a little bit too because it's like you're sweating so much. And the same thing with the bacteria, right? And the fungi and the yeast and all this stuff. There's an optimal temperature range, you know, that each of them operate in. When it's really cold or freezing, they're probably going to like maybe even go into hibernation. Some of them may die. And when they're a little bit warmer, then they're kind of like operating like really slow speed. Like, but then when it like gets in their optimal temperature range, as it will be in the springtime, hopefully fairly soon, they're just chugging along. They're just like, you know, eating and pooping and making nutrients for plants and everything's happy. And when it gets too hot, they're kind of just like, okay, we're just going to slow down and chill out. Maybe we'll go dormant for a little bit till this heat passes, right? And so, even though this might not be the best now, you know, to spray out. I mean, if you guys live in a climate where it's like snow outside, don't spray your EM1 in the snow. I mean, 50 degrees, I'm like good with 50 degrees. If it was in the 40s, like daytime averages were 40s, I probably wouldn't do it, you know, but today we're in the 50s. Hopefully we're gonna have a few warmer days and whatnot. And you know, the bacteria is gonna work slower, but doesn't mean it's like you shouldn't do it, right? The worst that's gonna happen is you're gonna waste 2 ounces of this to like add to a gallon or two of water, which is not a whole lot, right? And to get the potential benefits, right? Anyways, without further ado, you know, I gotta like get spraying this stuff. The sun's gonna be going down soon. It's gonna be get colder. And I wanna show you guys actually how I mix this stuff up and how I'm gonna apply this to my garden and some other reasons why I'm choosing to apply the EM1 in my garden today. All right, so unlike a compost tea that you actually got a bubble, using the EM1 is super simple. And that's one of the reasons why I like it. I got my backpack sprayer here. This is just basically a 4 gallon backpack sprayer from Harbor Freight Tool. I think with coupon, it was like just over 20 bucks, which is an amazing deal. It's been working many years. And also I put on the dual spray head on there, which is included. So I actually could get more spraying, you know, for the same amount of work. And the EM1, basically what you're supposed to do is you're supposed to take just 1 ounce for 1 gallon, right? You could use more, but you shouldn't use less. If you use more, basically you're probably just wasting more money. You're gonna have maybe a higher concentration of bacteria, but from the research it says 1 gallon per 1 ounce should be great. This is a 16 ounce bottle here, so literally I could just put a quarter of the bottle into my water. Now, I would encourage you guys to use like filtered water, right? This water in here, after the drinking water that's in my house that runs through two different filters, like a whole house filter and a reverse osmosis filter, this is the second best. This goes through my whole house filter, which has carbon, KDF, as well as a sediment filter. And then in addition, this goes through an additional KDF media to make sure all the chlorine is removed. That's particularly important, in my opinion, because the microbes can be sensitive to chlorine, because, I mean, they put chlorine in the water to kill the microbes so you don't get Girardian cryptosporidium, E. coli, and all these other contaminants. Use that. Oh, and then the other thing I did today is, because this is out of my shower water, I have a micro bubbler on my shower head, which basically puts micro bubbles or nano bubbles. That's a whole other topic we're not going to get into, but I'll probably make another video on that. And then the other thing I did was I didn't put it just cold water, right? The microbes like to be at a certain temperature, so I basically put lukewarm water, right? It's not super cold, it's not super hot. Coming out of the tap this time of year, it's a bit colder because of it's winter time, you know? So we're just going to go ahead and pop a hole in here, and we're going to put about a quarter of the bottle in there. Oops, I put a little bit more. Putting a little bit more is fine. And then basically what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and screw this on. And then I'm just basically going to take it as a backpack and walk it around. So let me show you guys the process. All right, so we're putting the backpack sprayer on. Super simple, super easy. And this guy can get a little bit heavy. And then how I like to shake it up is once I got on my back, I just shake it up a little bit. We're going to take off the, got the pump here. I got the unit. Let's see if I can get this off here. There we go. And basically all you do is you pump this. 4, 5, 6, 7, about 8 pumps until you basically meet resistance. And then I have the sprayer and I'm just going to start spraying it. And I just basically spray this everywhere. And as I'm holding it out to spray, I'm still pumping. And I just want to basically coat all the leaves, top side, bottom side, get all the soil, and basically just coat everything with this EM1 water solution to basically transplant all the beneficial microbes, the photosynthetic bacteria, the yeast, and the lactic acid in there on all my plants. And actually, as I spray this, it kind of smells a little bit like molasses, like smells really sweet. Now, the cool thing is I want you guys also, if you have dead plants that you have not yet removed, you also want to spray your dead plants with the EM1, right? I'm spraying the live plants here, and I'm spraying the dead stuff. Like, John, why are you spraying the dead stuff, man? You're wasting EM1. Well, actually, not really. The lactic acid bacteria will sense that these are not living plants anymore, and they'll start to break it down. And then by the time I cut these off and finally put them in my compost pile, you know, they're gonna help. And then now those bacteria are also gonna be into my compost pile to help the breakdown even further. And so even if I don't have anything planted right here, I just pulled out the peppers that frosted. You know, we're spraying the whole ground, so when I do plant, it will already be populated with all these beneficial microbes. You can even spray the trees. You know, so we got a moringa that we cut down. We're spraying all that. We're spraying all this. And basically, I'm just gonna spray everything in my entire garden, including me. No, just kidding. All right, so let me go ahead and show you guys actually three things real quick that the EM1, I think, saved my butt on. So the first thing the EM1 has saved my butt on, in my opinion, are my tree collards. So this is a tree collar. They're kind of getting a little bit sparse this time of year. I've been picking them back pretty heavy, as you guys can see, not a lot of leaf growth on this guy. Normally they grow like this, but this guy was basically stunted, right? For a while it had no top growth, no greenery growing, and I noticed that all the new emerging leaves that would come out would look really kind of like, I don't know, like funny. Like they were just malformed or deformed, or they just weren't growing properly. So I'm like, man, that has to be some kind of disease. So I literally took the EM1, just like I mixed up, and just sprayed it hardcore heavy, like all up where that stuff was going, right? Sprayed it everywhere just in case, like there's this funky bacteria or fungus or whatever on there. I sprayed it down real good, and then it started growing again. And now look, it has all new growth. And look at this one. This is the one that I treated heavily with the EM1. It has all these new buds. It's budding out all these new places. Has a lot more, even more vigorous growth than this guy. That, I mean, I also sprayed because I'm like, hey, I'm spraying that guy. Might as well spray this guy and protect it, because in case he gets, you know, some kind of fungus or disease from that guy, he's going to be protected too. So, I mean, that's one instance that the EM1 saved my butt. Let me go ahead and show you guys another one. All right, so now another reason why I'm choosing to spray the EM1 today and get more microbes into my soil and onto my plants, besides just seeing the amazing growth that Veronica got in the last episode, is because these tree collards here. So tree collards are my favorite plant, no joke. And you know, my other tree collards had some kind of disease, which may have been the same exact one or may have been different. I could not see anything visibly on the other tree collards, but on these guys, I definitely see some visible signs. So if you guys look at the back of this tree collard leaf, you guys will see like there's some kind of black spots, right? And there's different kinds of funguses and things that live on plants. And you could probably research this if you're a researcher. You know, I don't really care what kind of fungus it is. All I know is that I want the fungus gone off my plants, because this will contaminate all the leaves and take your plant health down and potentially kill your plant, right? So my easiest thing to do when I see this black spot leaf stuff is I basically pick off all the leaves and I send them off site. Get rid of them, right? Sometimes that's good enough to solve the issue, but if it isn't, that's when I get out the EM1, and I'll basically, once again, spray the EM1 to protect my plants against that black spot, to kill any kind of black spot that's on there. You know, in my opinion, based on me doing this, it totally works. So you can see my new tree collards that I just got, that I transplanted up to 1 gallon, and you can see these nice, big, huge ones that are nice and healthy that I have been growing for probably like a month or two, right? So let's go ahead and continue and show you one more use where the EM1 saved my butt. All right, another place I like to use EM1 that really hasn't saved my butt too much, but has definitely helped out with my compost breaking down and reducing the smell that it actually gives off when it's composting, if you don't have a good enough mixture. They also actually have used the EM1 to reduce like the smells of garbage, you know, at garbage haulers. So actually, because of the shutdown of the US government, a lot of garbage is not being picked up in parks, and it might be good to spray the EM1 if they had the labor to do that, to reduce the smell. But what I like to do is actually just take some of the EM1, and not a whole lot, but basically just spray it into my compost, right? And make sure that all my compost has a little bit of EM1, so I'm basically inoculating this with the microbes. And what you'll find is that if you just spray just a little bit on there to inoculate it, your compost is going to break down faster, and it may even be more nutritious. So I think that's pretty much the end of this episode today. I just really wanted to talk to you guys about EM1, how easy it is to just mix, put in a backpack sprayer, and spray out, get into your garden, introduce to your plants for disease resistance, spraying your compost to help it break down, and even spraying your dead plants so that when you harvest them and put them in here, you're going to be, once again, inoculating that into your compost pile. I'm all for all beneficial microbes, whether they're EM1, whether they're compost, whether you're going to make your own IMOs, I don't really care. I want you guys to do as many of them as you guys can afford. I mean, if you don't have any money, then hey, do the IMOs made with your own rice. If you could have your own compost that you make your own compost tea with that. Hey, if you got some extra disposable income, get the EM1, you know, use them all. And so that's the message of this story, this episode today. And meanwhile, I got to get back to spraying all my EM1 to coat every single area of my garden so I could give my plants the protection and also I could have faster growth, which means I'm gonna be eating more out of my garden than from the grocery store. So if you guys enjoyed this episode, please be sure to like this episode, give me a thumbs up. Also be sure to share this video with other people online so they could learn about the differences between EM1 compost tea and how easy EM1 is to spray. Oh, also be sure if you guys wanna order the EM1, link is down below, and make sure you use the coupon code GYG2019 for a special discount I have arranged for all my viewers. Also be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new and upcoming episodes. I've coming out about every 3 to 4 days. You never know where I'll share, but we'll be learning on my YouTube channel. And make sure you click the little bell so you get notified. YouTube has been unnotifying some people for some reason. And then finally, be sure to check out my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over 1,400 episodes at this time on this YouTube channel dedicated to you guys. The best ways to grow the highest quality food at your home. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.